Welcome to Math Homework Hotline, where we do the math. I'm your host, Canella Prado.
And I'm your co-host, Grayson Casco. And our fun theme tonight is Think Pink for October.
That's right. So October, as you know, is breast cancer awareness. And every year on the show, I like to tell my personal story of my family's personal story with breast cancer. And if you are a repeat viewer of the show, you're going to learn a little bit more about me. So every year I have said that I lost my mother in 2012 to breast cancer. But this last spring, I found out something new. My sister, my full biological sister, Barbara, she was diagnosed with a triple negative breast cancer. And the reason I'm telling you this is because that led to this summer me getting genetic testing, because she got it and found out that she is BRCA1, and that is the breast cancer gene. So I'd like to show a picture of my mom and my sister right now. This is my mother, Carola, and my sister, Barbara, on her wedding day 16 years ago to her current husband, Darwin. And so Barbara is, in fact, BRCA1 positive. We assume that that was from my mother, who we lost to breast cancer. And so I decided to get the genetic testing. And the reason I'm sharing this story is it's really important for you to understand how important that is if you have breast cancer in your family background. It turns out that I am not, in fact, BRCA1 positive. I'm very thankful for that.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Thanks. But my niece and nephew from my sister, she has a son and a daughter. The daughter is not negative. She does not have BRCA1, but her son does. And that means he's at an increased risk for prostate cancer, and also that he could pass that gene on if he were to have daughters. So I just wanted to kind of enlighten everyone about genetic testing and how important it can be, because you might think, well, I only have sons, so it doesn't matter, but it can pass on then to a granddaughter through their father. So I just wanted to share that story and encourage everyone not only to get those mammograms, but also if you have a history, consider genetic testing. Mine literally cost $12 at Moffitt. $12. Wow. After the insurance kicked in, it was $12 to find out, and they tested me, I think, for 17 types of cancer. And I was completely cancer, genetically cancer-free. That doesn't mean I won't get cancer environmentally, but I just wanted to share that with you. So think pink this October, get those mammograms, and consider genetic testing if it applies to you.
Yeah, I might have to go myself.
Yeah, like, you know, if you've got that, if you've got that gene in your family, you should probably check into it. All right, so let's get on to some math now, okay?
Yes.
So get on those phones. Call us at 813-840-7260. And that is Spectrum Channel 635, Frontier Channel 32. Or you can take us on the go. You don't even have to be at home, at mathhomeworkhotline.com. Any device that would have, what I'm trying to say here, connection to the internet of any kind, would work perfectly fine. So call us, 813-840-7260. We have those wonderful Hillsborough County math teachers in back waiting to take your call and help you with any math question.
Yes.
But that leads us to what
our topic
is
for tonight.
Yeah.
Our topic for tonight is operations with fractions. And so we're going to be working with a bunch of problems that have to do with fractions. And of course, that is what our challenge problem has to do with as
okay,
well.
Okay, let's show the topic card. There you go. All right, operations with fractions is tonight's topic.
Yes, it is.
And you gave us a peek, sneak peek that we're going to now show.
Yes, our challenge question of the night. Make sure you kids get ready with your phone so you can take a picture of that challenge problem. And you can work on it throughout. Keep in mind that the first one to call in with the correct answer to that challenge question is our Jemmy Prize winner of the night. So if we get that challenge problem up on the screen, please. Okay, kids, get ready to take a picture. Our challenge problem of the night says that candy comes in 3.5-pound bags. At a class party, the boys in the class ate 2.25 bags of candy, and the girls in the class ate 1.33 bags. How many pounds of candy did the class eat? I know they ate a bunch already.
That's a lot of candy,
yeah.
I will say
I
that.
I love Halloween, too.
Yeah, it's coming. So this class party with tons of candy. So take that picture real quick. Grab that screenshot and get to doing that math. And then the first caller is going to win a whole lot of prizes.
A whole lot of fun prizes.
So are you ready to show them what kind of prizes they might win there, Grayson?
So as always, our Jemmy Reward Prize winner will be winning the Math Homework Hotline t-shirt. This is new this year. Very comfortable t-shirt.
I wear mine every week. And don't
our
forget
Jemmy
the
plaque. This will be sent to your class with your name on it. And this goes out to the first caller who can give us the correct answer for this challenge question. We also got a tote bag for Math Homework Hotline, pencil case with a bunch of supplies, and as always, who doesn't love free food from Chick-fil-A and McDonald's?
Ooh, I do.
That's the best part.
Yeah, middle schoolers can never get enough food. I feel like they're just middle schoolers, high schoolers, even fourth and fifth graders. They can
any
eat you
age
out of house and home, right?
Any age loves free
that's
food.
Right, that's right. Growing kids love to eat. Okay, all right. So this week, in fact, let's talk about who won last week. So I think we have a photo of our Jemmy Award winner from last week. Do we have that? Okay, so here is Daniel from Miss Applegar's class at Benito Middle School. Congratulations. You can see he's already sporting his t-shirt and his bag is in his hand. You can't really see that, but he got all his goodies and Miss Applegarth was happy to pose with him, and we'll share in our sharing his photo tonight. We also want to give a shout out real quick to Strawberry Crest. We've got some students there at Strawberry Crest. Thank you for tuning in tonight and working along with us. And so don't forget, you're going to be that Jemmy Award winner, just like Daniel, if you are the first to call in. So the last thing we want to talk about is our Teacher Jemmy winner. So our
yes.
Teacher Jemmy gets one of these beautiful things, too. I've got one myself. Pretty proud of it. Hangs on my wall. And it will have your teacher's name and the school. And then the teacher who wins this not only will get this wonderful plaque, will get a good amount of gift cards to McDonald's or Chick-fil-A. And you can give those out to the students who are, you know, helping, you really feel deserve it, who are really working hard and deserve that extra little treat there. So tonight's show and the next two shows are the last show, tonight's show, and the next two shows. Those four shows combined, the teacher with the most calls wins the plaque and the big giant bunch of gift cards for the kids to go get some great food from one of our sponsors, either McDonald's or Chick-fil-A.
Yeah,
so thank you to them.
To call more.
Yeah, you got to get your kids
yeah,
it. Yeah.
And keep in mind that once you win the Teacher Jemmy Award, you cannot win again. So there are a bunch of opportunities
for
teachers out there in our county to win, and like myself included. But yeah, please encourage your students to keep calling, even if you've already won, you know, just so they can keep getting those prizes for being a Jemmy Award winner and so that they can spread the awareness out and get more kids to call in as well.
All right. So keep calling us. We need callers, guys. 813-840-7260. Give us a call. We are going to start, though, now with a little warm up on some fraction operations. So if we could go to my board, I got just a little bit of notes here. So when we're multiplying fractions, that's really the easiest one, in my opinion. Kids are always like, wait, no, adding and subtracting is easier. Not in the case of fractions. In the case of fractions, and we've got an example of AB times CD, all you do is multiply across the numerators. So in this case, it would be A times C. And then multiply across the denominators. It is literally like third grade math up and down, right? Like numerators, denominators, love that. Dividing fractions is a little tiny bit more difficult because you have to remember the little trick. And of course, I have a song for it. So when we're talking about AB divided by CD, what we have to do is we have to keep the first fraction, change to multiplication, and then flip the next fraction. So it becomes A over B times D over C. Okay? So A over B times D over C. So I always say to divide by a fraction, here's a tip. Keep, change, flip. So I will literally start singing that when kids are like, I don't remember how to divide a fraction. I go, to divide by a fraction, here's a tip. Keep, change, flip. Okay, so when we're adding and subtracting fractions, we have to find a common denominator. So in this case, we have A over B plus C over D. We would have to multiply A over B times D, numerator and denominator, and C over D times B, numerator and denominator, and that would end up being AD plus BC over BD plus BD. So the BD becomes the denominator then. So in that case, you keep the denominator and just add across to get the numerators. That one's a little bit more easy to see with numbers, but it is the most complicated. So what kids usually think is that multiplying and dividing sound way harder. In actuality, they're the easiest things to do with fractions. So there you go. All right, are you ready for your first problem tonight?
Yes, I am. I'm definitely ready. So if we go down to my board, I already have it set up for us. It's a simple problem. Model the expression 1/3 times 1/2. So I have a bunch of students who are visual learners, and I always say, if you have trouble figuring out what it's telling you to do, try drawing it out.
I love that.
We always start with our whole. So I just draw a square to represent my whole. We're going to start with 1/3. So in one direction, always with horizontal is how I like to start it, we're going to cut this whole into thirds. So one whole, and now it's 3/3. 1/3, 1/3, and 1/3. Then we're going to take the 1/2 and go in the other direction. Take the whole 1 whole, and we're going to cut it in half. Here's 1/2, here's 1/2. And then let's fill in what we got. We have our 1/3. And then we have, from our 1/2, 1/2. And both of those colors will intersect in one of these squares out of the 6. So when we model it, this lets us know that 1/3 times 1/2 is equal to 1/6. And just like in our warm-up, we know this is true because when we multiply fractions, we go straight across. Numerator times numerator, denominator times denominator, and 1 times 1 is 1, 3 times 2 is 6. So we know that our model 1/6 is correct.
All right. I think we have a caller. Hi, is this Sohan from Ms. Hunt's class? Oh, you're the challenge winner.
That was fast.
Is that right? Did you win the challenge?
Yes.
Okay. All right. So I'm going to get the challenge question real quick. And then I'm going to reread it for the people at home so they can catch up. And then you're going to tell me how you solved it. How do you feel about that? Okay. All right. Let's go to the board. Let me read the question. And so that everybody's on the same page. Okay. So candy comes in 3.5-pound bags. At a party, the boys ate 2 1/4 bags, and the girls ate 1 1/3 bags. How many pounds did they eat at the party? So what was the first step you did to figure out how much total candy was eaten?
So the first step that I did was I multiplied the amount of candy the boys ate by 3.5.
Okay, so the boys ate 2 1/4, right? Mm-hmm. Times mm-hmm. You said 3.5?
Yes.
So let me ask you this. Did you then switch 2 1/4 to a decimal?
Yes.
You did. Okay. So when you switched it to a decimal, what did you get?
0.25.
Okay. Yeah. So it would be 2.25 times 3.5, right?
Correct.
And this is the boys, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. So how much was that when you multiplied that together?
About 7.875.
Okay. All right. And then the girls, I'm assuming you did the girls next, yes?
Yes.
So what did you multiply?
I multiplied the amount of candy the girls ate by 3.5 as well.
Okay. So did you use like 1.3 repeating or 1.33? What did you use?
I did 1.3 repeating.
Okay, 1.3 repeating times 3.5. Mm-hmm. And what did you get?
I got 12.54. No, I didn't.
Okay. What did you get?
I got 4.655.
4.655?
Mm-hmm.
Did you have to do any rounding there, or what did you do?
So what I did was I multiplied 1.33 times 3.5.
Okay. I have a slightly different number, but we're going to go with, I got 4.6 repeating, but close enough. We're talking hundreds here. It's getting into the fine print. All right. So then what was your last step that you got?
Then I added the two.
So you added the two together. Okay. So when you added 7.875, right?
Mm-hmm.
Plus 4.6, you said 5.5, right?
Yep.
What'd you get?
So I got...
I think you said it just a second ago.
12.54.
Okay. Yep. I'll take it. Again, I'm a little bit like maybe a hundredth off, but it's okay. So 12.54 pounds of candy, approximately, because we're, you know, using decimals with repeating. It's close enough, right? Oh, that's the world's worst approximately. Okay, let's try that again. That's slightly better. All right, so excellent job. I like that she chose to go the route of converting our fractions into decimals, but you could have left them fractions as well, but it's always good to show things multiple ways because mathematical thinking and reasoning skills are number two. All right, so thank you so much for calling in. We'll get those prizes out to you right away.
Yeah, congratulations.
Congratulations, good
she
job.
And I think we have another caller on the line. Am I speaking with Arjun from Hunt's class at Williams?
Yes.
Hi, how are you doing, Arjun?
I'm doing good.
Awesome, that's great to hear. Are you ready to do the math with me?
Yes.
Okay, let's get started on our problem. I love the enthusiasm.
Me too. We're
so, Arjun, our problem here says which expressions have equivalent values to 1/3? So we have four expressions right here, and we want to see which of them is equal to 1/3. It could be multiple, so we're going to go through each of them. All right, you ready?
Yes.
Perfect. So let's start with A. We got 1/2 times 2/3. How would I go about solving this?
To solve A?
Yes. How would I multiply these fractions?
So to multiply them, first you put down 9 with 9.
Okay, so when we multiply fractions, we multiply straight across, right?
Yeah.
Right, so numerator times numerator, and then denominator times denominator. So rewriting this fraction, let's multiply these. 1 times 2 would be at the top, and then 2 times 3 would be at the bottom, right?
Right.
What is 1 times 2, Arjun? 2, and then that goes over 2 times 3, which would equal?
6.
Awesome, great job. We can simplify that though, right?
Yeah.
Great, what can I divide both 2 and 6 by so I can simplify this fraction?
You can divide 2 and 6 by 2.
Correct, they're both even numbers, and every even number can be divided by 2. So we divide both by 2. I'm going to use pink today since we're thinking pink. What's 2 divided by 2?
That's 1.
Great. And 6 divided by 2?
3.
3. So we see right here that A is an equivalent expression to 1/3. Right, Arjun?
Right.
Awesome. So let's circle that one because we know that's correct. Let's go right into the next one. We got 3 over 9 times 4 over 4. And like you already told me, we multiply straight across, right?
Right.
Okay. So I'm going to write it out for you. 3 times 4 over 9 times 4, and what do you get as an answer?
You get 12/36.
Correct, 12 over 36, and we can simplify that as well, right?
Yeah.
What is the greatest common factor that I can use to simplify and divide both 12 and 36, Arjun?
12.
Great job. 12 and 36 can both be divided by 12. So when we divide both those numbers, what do we get as our final answer?
We get 1 over 3.
1 over 3 again. So our expression 3/9 times 4/4, that whole is also equal to 1/3. Great job. Let's keep going. Next is C. We got 3 over 8 times 2 over 3. You already know what to do. We're going to multiply our numerators 3 times 2, multiply our denominators 8 times 3. What do you get as an answer, Arjun?
think, over 24.
Okay, and we can simplify that as well?
Yeah.
What can I divide both 6 and 24 by?
6.
Good job. Divide by 6. Divide by 6. What's our answer for C?
Our answer for C is 1/4.
1/4, right, because 6 divided by 6 is 1, 24 divided by 6 is 4. So this one is not equivalent to 1/3, right? So C is not an answer. And we got one more we need to check. We got 1/2 times 3/5. I'll go ahead and set it up for you. 1 times 3 over 2 times 5. What will that equal, Arjun?
That would equal 3 over 10.
Thank you. And can we simplify 3 over 10?
No.
No, we cannot. There's no number that can divide both 3 and 10, at least not without leaving a remainder. So is D an answer?
No.
No, it is not. Our answers for this problem are A and B. Thank you for calling, Arjun. You did a fantastic job.
He was like a young professor.
Yeah,
he did a really great young math professor. I adored him. All right, so we have another caller. Is this Kirsten?
Yes.
Hi, Kirsten. I am going to, I hope you saw Mr. Casco do a modeling question with multiplication. I'm going to do one with division. Are you ready to join me?
Yes, I'm on.
Okay, all right. So it says, what is the solution to the fraction expression that is modeled below? The first thing I wanted to talk about, Kirsten, is what is the fraction? So this first one, do you see that there's orange squares and white squares over here?
I can see it right now.
Okay, give it just a second. So okay, good. So how many orange squares is in this first rectangle? In this first
rectangle?
Nine, right. Nine out of how many? There's three more, so 9 plus 3 is? So 9 and then 10, 11, 12. See that?
Yeah, 12.
Okay, so how about the second fraction that's being modeled? We have how many orange squares?
4.
Out of 12 as well, right?
Yes.
So the first thing you would have to do is make sure, if you're using a model, is to make sure that you're out of the same amount. And in this case, we are. We're out of 12 each time. So why this helps kids that are not amazing at the keep, change, flip in the beginning is it helps them to understand what we're doing is we're trying to see how many groups of four orange we have. See, like, I'm going to draw a blue line around this. Ready? See how I have four orange right here? And I drew a blue line around. All right, so now we're going to come over here to the 9, and we're going to try to draw as many 4s as we can. So let's start. I'm going to draw it real thick. I'm going to kind of make an upside down L shape here. Can you see that that's 1?
Yes.
Okay, so that would be 1. I promise you're going to be getting to do some math soon. Okay, that's the 1. And then I'm going to draw a regular L shape here. See that? That would be the second one. So that would be 1 as well. Okay. And then that leaves us one little piece over. Okay. So that's kind of how it starts, that we know that we're going to have 2 with 1 left over. Okay. So now I'm going to come back here and I'm going to say, this is the easy way that they teach you to do it. You would count the 9 and put it in your numerator, and then count the 4 and put it in your denominator. And if we did that, okay, so how many groups of 4 are in 9? We're going to turn this into a mixed number. How many groups of 4 can fit into 9? I think
it's 2.
2, perfect. Yes, I thought you said 2, but it kind of got cut off. 2 with how much left over?
4.
1 left over, right? Because 2 times 4 is 8, there would be 1 left over. So it's 2 and 1/4. Now, the last thing I'm going to do is I'm going to show you that you can keep, change, flip this. Do you think you can help me with that? So we got 9/12 divided by 4/12. Just to check your work, we're going to keep 9/12. We're going to change, keep, change to the multiplication. And then we're going to flip 12 over 4. Now, do you know anything about cross simplification?
12.
Okay. So when you are crossing like this, okay, like see this 12 and this 12, if you can, if they would both divide by the same number, you could get rid of them. All right? So you can make them smaller. But in this case, 12 and 12 are the same number, right?
Yes.
Okay, so we could just make this become 1 because there's one group of 12 and 12 and one group of 12 and 12 there. And when we multiply across, we're going to get 9 over 4, which again, you see right here, is 9 over 4, which is 2 and 1 fourth. So there's like three different ways to look at a division problem using a model. Okay? You did a great job. Thank you so much for calling in. Oh, we have another caller.
We have another caller already. Yeah. Yeah. Keep them coming. Our All next right. caller tonight is Reese. Is this Reese from Prado's class at Walker?
Yes.
Okay. Welcome, Reese. You ready to do the math with me?
Yes, I am.
Okay. Let's give it a shot. So my question for you says, Betty made 3/5 of the pink pins. We are thinking pink tonight. So 3/5 of the pins were made by Betty. Barbara made 5/8 of the pins that Betty made. What fraction of the pins did Barbara make? So we're going to take these fractions. We know that Betty made 3/5. Barbara made 5/8 of the amount of pins that Betty made. So what kind of problem do you think we're going to be doing here? What operation will we use?
Yeah.
Correct. We're going to be multiplying these numbers together because it's saying of the amount that Betty made. So we need to take that 3/5 and multiply it to 5/8. So I'll set this up for you right here. 3 over 5, and we're multiplying it to 5 over 8. And Reese, do you know how we multiply fractions?
You convert them to the decimal.
So we could do that, but I'm going to challenge you a little bit tonight, Reese.
Okay.
If we are just want to keep it in fraction form, how can I multiply these two fractions together?
You could either use the vertical.
So I want to go straight across, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so let's go numerator times numerator, and then denominator times denominator. That's how we can multiply these fractions together. Okay, Reese?
Okay.
All right, so let's go ahead. You can do this for me. What's 3 times 15?
15.
Sorry, I gave you the answer. That's just testing you, Reese. 3 times 5 is 15. Thank you for catching that. And what is 5 times 8?
5 times 8 is 40.
Perfect. So I got 15 over 40, but I can simplify that, correct?
Yes.
What can I divide both 15 and 40 by?
5?
Yeah, I can divide both by 5. Divide by 5. Divide by 5. And that gives, what would that give us? What's 15 divided by 5?
15 divided by 5 is 3.
Right.
And then 3 divided by 5 is 8.
3/8. That is correct. I miswrote this one over here.
It happens.
Yeah. The answer C is 3/8. That is the correct answer for us. Thank you, Reese, for helping me out solving this problem.
Yeah, that was a good way. That was a good way to check your work. And Reese did all the math right, so we knew that there had to be a little typo somewhere. I knew he was correct. That's right,
yeah,
so
that
there was
one
a little
was
typo.
Me.
Happens, it's live TV, a lot of moving parts. Okay, all right, so I am going to do a multiplication with mixed numbers. And you're going to learn my famous Ferris wheel method. So let's go to the board. It says, what is the value of 1 1/3 times 3 1/2? So I like to call it the Ferris wheel method. Just, I don't know, it's kind of like a cute thing. So why it's called the Ferris wheel method is that you start at the bottom and you kind of go to the top like a Ferris wheel, okay? So you take the denominator and multiply it by the whole number, and then you add the numerator. So we're going to take that and we're going to have 3 times 1 is 3 plus 1 is 4 over 3. Then we're going to Ferris wheel this one, 2 times 3 plus 1. So it's going to be 4/3 times 2 times 3 is 6, plus 1 is 7, 7, and then you just put it over the denominator. So you Ferris wheel to get the numerator, and then you put it over the denominator. So yay. All right, so now remember what we have been learning all night, right, is that we just multiply across the top and then we multiply across the bottom. But you know what I see? I have to show it. I see a chance to cross simplify. So when we're cross simplifying, we're looking at the ones like catty corner from each other, diagonally, right? And we say, can we simplify 4 and 2 in any way? And yes, their greatest common factor is 2. So this would become 1 because 2 divided by 2 is 1. And this would become 2. And maybe you really didn't need to do that with these smaller numbers, but if you have really big numbers, it's helpful. So now we do what Grayson said, 2 times 7 in the numerator and 3 times 1 in the denominator, so we end up with 14 thirds. Now I'm going to show the old-fashioned way. If you don't have a calculator with a change it to mixed number kind of situation, so what you would do is you would take 14 and you divide it by 3. Old-fashioned way, put 14 in the house. I don't know, did you learn it that way, Grayson?
Yeah, that's how I learned it.
Yeah, okay. Up. So how many times does 3 go into 14? Well, it goes in there 4 times. And that would give us 3 times 4 is 12. And you would subtract and you'd get 2. So we know that 3 can't go into 2, so you just put it as 2 over 3. And that is, in fact, our answer. 4 and 2 thirds is the answer to this question. So there you go. We learned Ferris wheel. We learned another little example of cross simplifying. I really encourage my kids to learn to cross simplify because it really does help, especially when you get into algebra.
Yeah. So I always say whatever works is the best method
exactly,
for you as long
exactly.
as you get the answer right.
I 100% agree. 100%.
All right. I think we have some t-shirt winners now.
There we go.
For the
Yay.
Night. So our t-shirt winners for the night are, I think we have Landon from York, Olivia from Cullens, and Preston from Benito. Congratulations to those students for being our t-shirt winners of the night. Thank you for calling in and participating. And
okay, so I think our next is going to be Ed Gems. We want to thank our sponsor, Ed Gems.
Always thank you, Ed Gems.
With one of their special parts of their whole presentation to us to help parents and kids in our community. So let's look at tonight's, what's our featured item tonight? Okay, so tonight's featured item is the table of contents. So students can use this to preview or a review of each lesson's title and target, especially like if you're studying back for a test, you might want to go back to a table of contents and see if, you know, that particular item there you want to study is in there. And so, and you can use all, you can see all, preview all key vocabulary words in the unit. And this is located as the cover page for each unit in the student workbook. I find these really helpful for, like I said, when you're doing reviews, either like just an assessment review or like what we're, a lot of us are having here soon, like the whole quarter one progress monitoring assessment. This would be great for the kids to figure out, you know, okay, is this in this particular section for me to review? So, and parents too, tables of contents are just really helpful in navigating their way through the EdGems book. Okay, I think we have a caller. Are you good to go over there, Grayson?
Yeah, I'm ready. Sophia.
All right.
Am I talking to Sophia from Prado's class at Walker?
Yes.
Okay, welcome to the show, Sophia. Thank you for calling in. Let's go to my board. You ready?
Yes.
Okay. My problem says, what is the value of 2 and 2 thirds divided by 4 and 1 sixth? You ready to start this problem, Sophia?
Yes.
Okay, so I always tell my students that if you are working with mixed numbers, sometimes it's easier to first switch it into an improper fraction. Do you know how to change a mixed number into an improper fraction?
Yes.
How do I do that?
Ferris wheel.
I think she said Ferris wheel.
Yeah, the Ferris wheel method, yeah. And that Ferris wheel method is telling me to do what?
3 times 2, which would be 6.
Right, I'm going to multiply my big number, that times that denominator, and then what?
It'd be 8 over 6.
And I'm going to add that numerator. So 2 times 3 would be 6, like you said, plus 2 would be 8. So 2 and 2 thirds, we're going to change that to 8. And what would my denominator be?
3.
It stays the same. Good job. And let's do the same thing to our other mixed number, 4 and 1 sixth. We multiply that 4 and the 6, then add the 1. What would that give me?
8 over.
4 times 6 is 24, right?
Oh.
Plus the 1. You still there, Sophia?
Yeah.
So I think it might have been cut off, but 25 over 6, right? Okay, so now that we have these as improper fractions, we can divide them. And what's the most important thing that we need to do when we're dividing our fractions?
Keep,
change, and flip. Just like the song from the beginning. If you need a tip on dividing fractions, keep, change, flip. So we're going to keep our 8 over 3 the same. We're going to change our division to multiplication. And then we're going to flip our 25 over 6 and make it 6 over 25, right?
Yep.
Okay, so let's multiply that. I'm going to move it down here just so we have a little bit more room. What is 8 times 6, Sophia?
8 is 48.
48. And then underneath that in our denominator, 3 times 25?
75.
And we can simplify that, right? Is there a number I can divide both 48 and 75 by?
2.
So almost, 75 is an odd number, so we can't divide an odd number by 2 without leaving a remainder. But you're very close. One more than 2.
3.
48 and 75 are both divisible by 3. We can divide that by 3 and it won't leave any remainder or decimal. So let's go ahead and do that. What is 48 divided by 3, Sophia?
16 over 16.
And then 75 divided by 3?
25.
16 over 25 is correct. And that is our most simplified form of this fraction. And that is answer B. Thank you so much for your help, Sophia, on doing the math. You
very
did great.
Nice job, Sophia. Thanks for calling in. I think we have Tanisha. Is this Tanisha? Hi, Tanisha. Tanisha, are you with us from Ms. Hunt's class?
Yeah, I'm right here.
Yay, okay, we got you. All right, so we're gonna do a word problem with fractions. Are you ready?
Yep.
All right, let's go. Okay, so Kara uses 1/4 cup of syrup to make her pink drink. I think they have one of those at Starbucks, don't they? All right, she has 3 cups of syrup left.
Yep.
How many drinks can she make? Tanisha, I need you to please turn down the
device. I'm here. Sorry.
That's okay. I need you to turn down the device that you're watching on. Okay, so you can... The device you're listening on, you can you're fine with, but the device you're watching on, yeah. I think we did it backwards. Okay, I think we may have lost Tanisha. Yes, we did. The aliens have landed. We lost Tanisha. All right. Okay. So, do we have another caller? Is this Sahidi? Is there another caller? Hi. Is this Sahiti?
Yeah.
Am I pronouncing your name right?
It's Shad.
Okay. And you're from Miss Applegar's class at Benito?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you for calling in. We have a fraction problem we're going to do here on my board. Are you ready?
Yeah.
All right. So I'm going to read it again. Kara uses 1/4 cup of syrup to make her pink drink. She has 3 cups of syrup left. How many drinks can she make? Okay. So I see the number 1/4. Here, and I see the number 3. So what operation do you think we're going to do with this? Add, subtract, multiply, or divide? Okay, I think you, what did you say? I'm sorry, I kind of lost you.
I think
you're saying divide, okay? So, all right, so we're going to divide. So tell me how you would write this out.
I think it's 3.
Yeah, I agree. She said 3 divided by 1/4. That's right. So when we divide by a fraction, here's a tip. What do we need to do? Keep, change, flip, right? So we're going to keep the 3, turn it into multiplication, and flip the 4 and make it become 4 over 1. Now, when we have a whole number like 3, can we turn it into a fraction really easily? So could we just put it over 1?
Sure.
Yeah, okay. So now, what do we do next?
So, you have 3 times 4?
Yes, you take 3 times 4. And you're going to get what?
12.
And then on the bottom, we have 1 times 1, right?
Yeah.
Which would give us 1. So, is our answer A, B, C, or D? Which one is the answer? We got 12 over 1, so which one would it be, A, B, C, or D?
D.
D. Not a trick question, right? Ding, 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 ding. You did a great job with that. I really appreciate you calling in. And thanks, and hopefully you'll call back sometime. All right, we have another caller and another problem.
Yes, let's keep
going
right on to the next one. Let's keep it rolling. And am I speaking with Susma from Kelly's class at Williams?
Yeah.
Hi, how are you doing tonight, Susma? You ready to do the math with me?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, perfect. I already got it set up for us. So, my problem says that Xavier has 12 pink shirts. Each is 1¼ centimeter thick. If he stacks all 12 shirts, how tall would the stack be? So, we know we have 12 pink shirts, and we know that those 12 shirts are 1¼ centimeters thick each. So, what do you think the operation I'm going to be doing is with these? Yeah, I'll read it for you again. Xavier has 12 pink shirts. Each shirt is 1¼ centimeters thick. If he stacks all 12 shirts, how tall would the stack be? My question for you is, what operation, either adding, subtracting, multiplying, or dividing, do you think we'll need to use to solve this answer, this problem? Are you still there, Susma? Oh, I think it might have been cut off. Might have lost it there. Yes, they have. All right, well, I guess I'll just tackle this problem for us. We know that if each is 1¼ centimeter thick, that we need to multiply those 12 pink shirts by the 1¼, just so we can know how tall it will be all together. So let's set it up. We have 12. We're going to multiply it to 1¼. And just like the last problem I did, whenever I'm working with a mixed number, I always like to make it an improper fraction first. And I also want to make my 12 a fraction as well. If you were listening to the last problem done, we can make any whole number into a fraction by putting it over a 1. So 12 will be 12 over 1. And then we're going to use our Ferris wheel to figure out what 1¼ would be as an improper fraction. So we're going to multiply that 1 by the 4. And then we're going to add that to the numerator, that 1 on top, just so we could get our new numerator. 1 times 4 is 4, plus 1, it would be 5. And our denominator is going to stay 4. So now our problem is 12 over 1, and we're multiplying that to 5 over 4. We multiply fractions straight across, numerator times numerator, denominator times denominator. So this will give us an answer of 60. Because 12 times 5 is 60, over 4. And from there, we can just divide. 60 divided by 4, and that tells us that our stack will be 15 centimeters thick when we put each shirt on top of each other. And that's the problem right there. I'm so bad we lost the call on him, but...
It happened.
I'm sure he would have gotten it.
Again, live TV, a lot of moving parts. Okay, so we have a question about pizza because, frankly, it's past the dinner hour and I'm getting kind of hungry. So let's go to the board. All right, so Liam ate 2/3 of a pizza. Liam was hungry. Okay. Oh, wait, we have Tanisha back. Hello, Tanisha. Do we have Tanisha back? It says we do. Hi, Tanisha. Hello, Tanisha. Are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
Okay, we've got a new problem for you. How do you feel about pizza? Okay. Do you like pizza problems? Because we got a pizza problem.
Yes.
love them.
All right, there we go. I love the enthusiasm. Okay, so Liam ate 2/3 of a pizza. Like I said, Liam was apparently very hungry. 2/3 of a pizza is a good amount. And then Alberto ate 1/6 of what Liam ate. That's because he ate more of a normal amount of pizza. So what fraction of pizza did Alberto eat? Okay, so we know we got 2/3, right? And we know we got 1/6. So do you know what operation we're going to do to solve this?
Multiplication.
Yes. And what did you see any words that kind of like gave you a hint? Did you notice any words that you're like, that one kind of seems like it's going to be multiplication?
Of.
I agree. So of frequently means to multiply. So that was a good instinct there. Okay, so we're going to take 2/3 times 1/6, correct? Okay. Now, how would you like to do this? What do you think that we should do next?
I think we should first write down the equation 2/3 times 1/6.
Excellent.
And then we can cross-simplify.
You want to cross-simplify. That's my girl, Tanisha. We're two birds of a feather. All right, so which numbers will cross-simplify?
2 and 6.
Okay, so what will 2 become?
1.
That's right, because both 2 and 6, their greatest common factor would be what?
2.
Yep, you've got it. So one group of 2 and 2, and how many groups of 2 and 6?
3.
That's right. Okay, so now what do? We've cross-simplified, so what's our last step here?
So next we have to multiply.
Right, multiply across the numerator, right? Mm-hmm. And when we multiply across the numerator, what are we getting?
1,
because 1 times 1 is 1. Now we're going to multiply across the denominators, and what will we get then?
9.
Okay, so Liam was really hungry, and Alberto was more in snack mode, right? So Alberto ate 1/9 of a pizza. Okay. So that's like he just had a snack, and Liam just ate it all. So thank you, Tanisha. Thank you for calling in. Thanks for working with me tonight. Okay, I think we have some T-shirt winners.
Yes, more T-shirt winners. Our T-shirt winners are Karthika from Farnell, John from Roland Park, and Joshua from Lutz. You will all be getting this fantastic new Math Homework Hotline T-shirt sent right to you. And thank you so much for calling in. And keep it up so you can keep winning.
That's right.
Okay, and then a little bit about our sponsor, Mathnasium.
Okay.
Yes, thank you for all the support, Mathnasium, that you show us. If we can get that up. Yes, Mathnasium proudly supports Math Homework Hotline. So call now to schedule a free assessment. You want to make math a priority this school year and discover why over 1 million parents have trusted Mathnasium to transform their children's math skills and to build their confidence in math. They have live face-to-face instruction, which is offered both in-center and online. So again, please call them for a free assessment now or at a nearby location. Those locations are Brandon, Carrollwood, New Tampa, Riverview, South Tampa, and West Chase. And just like we always say, you definitely have one by you, probably within 15 minutes of where you live. So please call those numbers so that Mathnasium can help you. Thank you so much, Mathnasium, for supporting us. And then we're going to go right into our next problem. We already have it set up for you. It's a little bit more of a challenging problem, but I don't think we'll have a problem with it. So we can go to my board. This one says, on Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, Josh runs 2 1/3 miles. On Tuesdays and Thursdays, he runs 2.5 miles. To reach his goal of 15 miles, how much more would Josh need to run on Saturday? So this is a problem that's going to be using both multiplying fractions and adding these fractions together. I'm going to go ahead and set up a little equation for us so that we can solve this. We know that 3 days out of the week, he runs 2 1/3. So let me just set this up, 2 1/3. We're going to be multiplying that to 3. Plus 2 days out of the week, he runs 2.5 miles. So 2.5 times 2. And we need to figure out how much more he needs to run. We don't know how much more, so we're going to leave that as x to reach his goal of 15 miles by Saturday. So let's go ahead and start solving this. 2 1/3, we can make that into an improper fraction by doing our Ferris wheel. 2 times 3, then add the 1. 2 times 3 is 6, plus 1 is 7, and I'm going to keep my denominator as that 3. And then 3, I can just make into an fraction by just putting it over 1. So 7 over 3 times 3 over 1 will be our first one. Plus, let's make 2.5 improper. 2 times 2 is 4, plus 1 is 5. So our new numerator is 5, and we keep that denominator as a 2. And again, we're going to make our whole number, that 2, into a fraction by putting it over 1. And the rest, I'm just going to move down. Plus x equals 15. So 7 times 3 is 21. Over 3 times 1 is 3. Our second fraction would be 5 times 2, which is 10. And we're going to put that over 2 times 1, which is 2. Plus x equals 15. Now let's divide. Let's add these together first. We need to make sure that when we're adding our fractions, that they have a common denominator. A way to always have a common denominator is to just multiply the numerator and denominator in each fraction by the other fraction's denominator. So times 2, times 2, times 3, and times 3. I'm going to move it up here for us just so we can see it a little bit clearer. 21 times 2, that would give us 42. 3 times 2 gives us 6. So our first fraction will become 42 over 6. Our second fraction, 10 times 3 is 30. And we're going to put that over 2 times 3, which is 6. And everything else, I'm just going to move with it. Now that they have a common denominator, we can add those numerators together. 42 plus 30 will give me 72 over 6. And then
that could be simplified, right?
That can be simplified, definitely. 72 divided by 6 equals 12. So when we have 12 plus x equals 15, we just have to think, what number plus 12 gives us 15? And that number, of course, is 3. So he needs to run 3 miles on Saturday so that he can reach his goal of 15 miles by the end of the week.
Pretty even throughout the week, right?
Yeah, more running than I do.
gave a little bit more run on Saturday when he got to sleep in a bit, maybe, right? Okay, all right, so I think we have a caller. Is this Preston from Miss Applegarth's class at Benito?
Yes.
I got to tell you, Miss Applegarth has had a lot of calls tonight. I think you might be in the running for some free food. Okay, you like free food? I bet you do. Yeah, who doesn't like free food, Preston? Come on. All right, so at the walkathon, Jenny walked 3 3/8 miles. Okay, so we got this number. And then we have Erica. She walked 5 3/4 miles. So the total walkathon miles was 80 times what Jenny and Erica walked. How many miles walked at the walkathon? So there's a couple different ways that you could do this. Do you think you have an idea of how you would like to start?
Not really.
That's okay. Okay, so what I would do is I would probably add what Jenny and the Erica walked, because that would be easier than multiplying both times 80 to me. So I'd like to multiply one number times 80 instead of two numbers times 80. And I know it's times 80 because it literally says. Okay, so what we just went over, right, is that when we are adding fractions, we have to find a common denominator. But these are mixed numbers, so what do we need to do first?
We need to turn them into proper fractions.
Right, so do you know how to turn 5 3/4 into an improper fraction?
Yes.
Can you describe that? Go ahead.
So basically what we would do is we would times 5 times 4,
uh-huh,
which is 20,
uh-huh,
and then with the leftover 3, we would add it to the 20, which would be 23.
So we're going to end up with 23 over 4, correct?
Yes.
Yeah, you just keep the denominator, right? Okay, so now do the other one. We got 3 3/8, so I call it Ferris wheel, but go ahead and do it. What would you get? 8 times
27 over 8.
I did too. We're on the same page, you and me. Okay, now, can we simply add these together or do they have a problem?
They have a problem.
Okay, what's the problem?
They won't have the same denominator.
That's right. Okay, so we're going to multiply. Can we multiply 4 by something to turn it into 8?
Yes, we can times it by 2.
Okay, so we're going to multiply top and bottom times 2, correct? Okay, so what's 23 times 2?
48.
I got 46 is what I got. You too?
Yes.
Okay, and then 2 times 4?
8.
Okay, so now we can cross out these guys. So now we got 46 eighths plus 27 eighths. Do you know what 27 plus 46 is?
23.
I got 46. Okay, 23. I'm going to check my work because you and I got different answers. That's what you do. Okay, so we got 23. Okay, 27. Did I do this right? Yes. Okay, so 27 and 46. What do we get? Okay, so we had 23 fourths, right? And we had to turn it into 46 eighths, correct?
Yes.
And then we had 27 eighths, right?
Yes.
And then 27 plus 46 is what?
73.
Oh, I'm sorry. I think you said it right the first time. I just couldn't hear you. Okay, so it's 73 over 8, right?
Yes.
Okay, now we're going to multiply it by 80. Now, this is one of those times where cross simplifying really helps a lot, okay? So,
okay.
Do we have, so 8 and 80 both divide by 8, correct?
Yes.
Okay, so there'd be one group of 8 and 8, and one group of 8 and 8, and 10 groups of 8 and 80, right?
Yes.
So now we just take 73 times 10, and what do we get when we take 73 times 10?
Okay. 730?
Yes, you just add a zero, right? So 730 yes. miles. That was one of those times where cross simplifying went really well. Sorry for the little audio conversion, but we made it. Okay, all right. Well, thank you so much for calling in. Good job tonight, Miss Applegar's class.
Yeah,
I also want
job.
To give a shout out to the district resource teachers with Maggie, who's one of our co-hosts, and all of them, but to Jen Galvin, because she came in today and observed me. So. Thank you to...
Yeah, we all love Jen.
Yes.
She observes me all the time.
Yes, all of our district resource teachers are wonderful for our teachers. So we want to wrap up tonight's show and say thank you again, remind you to get those mammograms and consider, genetic cancer screening if you, in fact, have that in your genes.
Definitely.
And
wear some pink, for the month of October. Show your support.
Pink on Mondays.
Spread the awareness because I definitely didn't know about that. Now I might get tested myself.
Yeah, so pink on Mondays to spread the awareness of breast cancer. And so next Thursday, October 19th, we have our a live show, Introduction to Functions. So that will be a good time. We'll put the fun in functions. How's that sound? All right. And our Oh, come on. Okay. And then our fun theme will be It's Fall, y'all. Okay. All right. So thanks so much for tuning
in. Thank you, everyone, for calling.
We'll see you next week.
Have a great
all
night.
Decked out for fall. And functions. Bye, everybody.